Good day to everyone. I'm sorry I can't see you well. My name is Meir Elran, and I am involved in areas related to Israeli society in various aspects. As a very important part, we think perhaps growing more and more important in our national security. Our panel today deals with an issue of the greatest importance, and it is further to the very important talk we heard yesterday from the president of the state, Reuven Rivlin, last night. I would like to draw something out of his speech, something he didn't say explicitly, but he did say on June 7th, 2015, regarding the tribal nature of Israeli culture. He talked about four tribes. He spoke about, and I quote, he said, "We need a wake-up call. The ultra-Orthodox, the secular, the religious, or the Arab cannot feel that what is most dear to them is under threat or in danger." According to the president, I quote again, "The new Israeli order requires to move from the accepted approach of a majority and minority to a new approach of partnership among the different sectors of Israeli society." And then he further added, "There are four elements upon which this partnership must stand. The first is the sense of security of each security, in that entering this partnership does not involve giving up the basic components of their identity. The second element is the mutual or joint responsibility. The third is fairness and equality. And the fourth is the most challenging, is creating a joint shared Israeliness." So we're talking about change. This conference is involved in talking about changes in the rules of the game, and there's a situation which we think we are in which in the internal Israeli subject we are at a very important juncture, and I'm talking currently mainly about the aspect of the highly charged relations between the Jewish minority and the Arab minority. We are at a juncture at which we ourselves need to decide together with the Arab population among us whether we are going in the direction of radicalism, extremism that is a danger, or are we taking the route of integration, of jointness that has a chance. In the past 3 years in the Institute, we've been focusing on this subject very intensively, and we want to bring this message. We believe that very important things are happening in Israeli society, in Israeli politics, that impact these two opposing trends very sharply, but from among this fog of the extremism on the one hand and the intolerable verbiage we are hearing as in the media and especially in the social media, there are some very important harbingers of change that are the possibility of integration into what the president called a new Israeli order. And that is what we would like to discuss today in this session, which I think is a very special one. First of all, it is special because we have chosen to present the subject of the relationship between Jews and Arabs in Israel and talk about where they are going and what direction they are going, what are the different options. And it is different also because we have brought, and we prefer to be, and I'm very happy at this, three women leaders from among the Arab public who will present to us, print these different perspectives on these subjects. I will introduce them in a moment, but I would like to but before I do so, excuse me for a moment, says the speaker. I'd like to show you a few slides from the survey that was presented yesterday by Tzipi, which talked about the aspects of how Israelis relate to the expanse in which we live. I would like to show you a few individual slides regarding the specific issue that we are discussing now. As she said yesterday, this is the first time we've done an in-depth survey of this type and presenting a survey of this kind. So we can see that Jews in Israel, after they're asked, how do you view Israeli Arabs who are citizens of Israel? 44% says they should be respected but also suspected. And 36 said, almost a third, said they view them as enemies. And only 20% said they are perceived by them as equals. When they were asked, the Jews, what Israel needs to emphasize in how it relates to its Arab citizens, 54%, more than half, said that indeed, and as Tippi said yesterday, this survey was held in the middle of this current wave of terror, 54% that Israel needs to increase the punitive elements for behavior on the part of Arabs that is not consistent with their being citizens of Israel. 26% said that Israel should emphasize making the conditions of life of Arabs equal to the conditions of lives of Israelis, and 20% said nothing needs to be done. I would say that this is perhaps a typical but not optimistic picture. On the other hand, we asked the Arabs who were surveyed by us, how would you define your identity to yourselves? Here, there's a whole list here, but what's important, as I see it, is that 70% define themselves in different ways as Israelis, and only 30% refuse to define themselves as Israelis in any way, shape, or form. But it would not be in any way part of the label for their identity. I think this is a very significant finding. If this slide shows the question that we asked the Arab people polled, what is the nature of your relationship with Jews in Israel? 53% said they had good relations with Jews. I think this is indicative of something that's quite clear. And 28% said that their connection with Jews was only at work. And about 20%, a little bit less, said, I'm not interested in any contact with Jews. And the final slide, I think the most important of all, the Arabs asked, what is the most important national question to you? 70% of those asked said that the most important issue is finding a solution. The red, I'm pointing to the red, equal rights for Arabs. Only 30%, less than a third of those polled, said that the most important issue to them is that of the rights of what they call the Palestinian people, in other words, the whole political issue of Israel's relationships with the Palestinians. So I think these findings speak for themselves, and I would like to talk about the implications of these things on the ground, indeed from the perspective of the Arab public in Israel. I'm sorry, if a gentleman doesn't speak into the microphone, he cannot be interpreted. Dr. Dalia Fadila is the principal of the Al-Qasimi Academy for Engineering and Science in Baka Al-Gharbiya. She's also the head of the School for Engineers, and she is a graduate of the Interdisciplinary Center Herzliya in Politics and Governance. Sitting next to her is Ms. Raunak Matur. She is the co-executive director of Security, the Association for the Advancement of Civil Equality in Israel, in housing, welfare, education, and so on, with an emphasis on subjects that are related to the work of the local governments and proper representation in the civil service. Raunak Matur has a degree from the Hebrew University. And our third guest is Dr. Shirin Natun Khafi. And she is the principal of the Arab Ord High School in Lod, and of it is the first Arab high school in Hord. She was formerly a member of the development committee of the in the municipality of Lod, and is a member of the plenary of the Israel Broadcast Association. So I think we have some very an interesting panel, and I would like to ask Dr. Dalia Fatila to relate to my introduction and to express her opinion regarding the issue that I noted regarding the juncture at which we find ourselves and where we are going. Good day to everyone. Before I do so, I would like to suggest a change in terminology, a conceptual change. I think we should use the words vision of a shared society rather than inclusion, but it's because inclusion, integration is a project, it starts, it ends, and the process of inclusion is very important, but it doesn't reflect the real picture. I would like to talk about a shared, equal society, to define a vision of Israeli society as a shared society, and from there to derive the policy and the work processes and the aims and targets, and from that point to talk as Arabs, as citizens, or rather as individuals, or a city, a community that needs to be included. The discourse of inclusion of tribes or Israeliness is one that is being heard more and more, and this is indeed a new stage. I'm not saying a juncture, but rather a new stage, despite all the difficulties and declarations. This is a new stage in Israeli public life. There are issues of employment and another initiative that integrates Arab citizens. For example, the inclusion of Arab women in Israeli work economy, in the work market. The percentage of Arab women working went from 18% to 26%, and the good news is that there are more Arab women who are integrated, and it should be noted that the percentage of Jewish women working is 80% to fewer than 30% among Arab women. And this is so important that Arab women start being empowered economically, but to have a lot more tellers and cashiers in supermarkets, that's not the only level that needs to be integrated. On the other hand, I would like to create a different visibility in the integration in employment. I would like to see educated women, women in key positions, women who are part of the decision-making process in the economic policies in Israel. Instead of just creating visibility at the lower levels of employment, we need to create visibility at a higher level to present all the aspects of Arab society, all the poles, all the levels, the educated classes, the less educated levels, and those that can be integrated into various jobs. The problem with integration and employment is that you think of a certain trend and not about the general population. You create visibility in one aspect but not in another, and I think that the inclusion of women in key positions in decision making, of policy, and in areas of education, employment, and economy, and in other areas, this could create new hope both for Jewish society and Arab society in Israel. And the initiatives from entrepreneurs, Trachtenberg's plan to make education more accessible for Arabs is a good thing. Sadly, the percentage of Arabs in higher education is 10% to 15% of the universities. There is still the drain to the universities in Jordan and in the Palestinian Authority. There is still this illusion that those who go to Jordan and get a certain type of higher education. This does not contribute to their integration into the Israeli economy, into the society from which they came. We get stuck in a closed circle where a lot of people have higher education, but they don't study in the relevant places, and they come with irrelevant education, and they don't advance society. Arab society since the 1950s is in this state of crisis between tradition and progress. There are a lot of people who are studying, but society is not moving ahead. I suggest looking at making education accessible not as the problem, but as the symptom. The problem is not in a higher education. The problem is in the Arab education system, which is really inadequate and not suitable to the 21st century or to Arab society or to Israeli society. We are talking about the younger age, elementary and junior high school, middle school and high school, the graduates of which are individuals who do not have the tools to become integrated into the Israeli academia or job market, and they cannot contribute either to their own community or to Israeli society as a whole. The problem with Arab education from among the four tribes that represent Israeli society, this section as different from the other tribes lacks a vision. There is an absence of vision. The question that should be asked in every education system, what do we want our graduates to look like in terms of values, in terms of cognitive tools, knowledge, and personal tools? There is an absence of a definition of a vision in the Arab education system, and that is why the goals that are decided on are not realistic or relevant, and the work plans are irrelevant. The Arab education system is still in the 7th century. It looks more like the third world as compared to the first world of the Israeli education system, the Jewish Israeli system, with all its various parts. We currently have eligibility for matriculations only barely 30%, and those who do meet the demands for education are less than 10%, and very few go the whole road. The problem of the Arab education system is the problem of lack of deficiency. It has the budget is a third of the Jewish budgets, and in the system itself there are the internal barriers and the external barriers. The internal barriers, everything that dictates the culture of management and teaching is still traditional. I do see a personal responsibility in the system, but I assign responsibility to the inspectorate from the Ministry of Education and the Education Policy. And I have to ask myself, what is the education policy of the Ministry of Education for the Arab sector? Should it be 7th century in the 24th century, or should it enable its graduates to acquire tools cognitively, knowledge-wise, and in terms of values to enable them to integrate? The problem starts in the kindergarten, in the elementary school, middle school, high school, and goes on in the Arab textbooks. When my daughter was in the 5th grade, and I helped her study, in Arabic, I found that all the texts in her book that is called El-Aid, which means the pioneer, regarding the image of women who belong to the 1950s, women are in the kitchen with a few chickens in the yard, they are not educated, and what angered me even more, and I told my daughter that this is enough with this, when I encountered the poem that describes how silence is so wonderful for women and what a virtue it is. And now we're talking about a voice of your own, of presence, of visibility, of advancement and processes. And our textbooks, and I blame
very much, and I'm emphasizing that I am angry at the inspectorate of the textbooks in the Ministry of Education, because those who wrote the book come from within society, and the committee that authorized and enabled the use of these books is a government committee. There is a terminology that I would like to get rid of, and that is cultural sensitivity. Well, let's get back to that at a later point. If I may, just one more sentence. We need to move from a discourse of inclusion and a joint equal society to move from a discussion of cultural sensitivity, which in parentheses is that if he wants to be a shepherd, let him be a shepherd. We need to move to a discourse of taking responsibility and making decisions both on the national level and for within society.
Well, I can just agree with Dalia, especially regarding the change of terminology and the strive for an equal society, which is actually what we do in CHEVS. That's what we call our organization of Jews and Arabs that works on change of images and a struggle for equal rights on the one hand and on the other to have a joint egalitarian Arab society. I think that's the key word. And I also want to relate to the data that you presented. It really saddens me to see that actually 80% of the Jews in Israel in a certain way suspect the Arab population. That's the delicate formula. Some see us as enemies, but from my point of view, the Israeli leadership and the decision makers in the Knesset and the government have a definite role, influential on the nature of the relations between Jews and Arabs, and actually they have an impact on these data. Recently we heard about the approval of the economic plan of the government to promote the Arab local authorities after many years of the discrimination, no development. On behalf of the government, we always documented it in our organization, and for years they were denied by the government. And here, finally, the government admits and understands that it has to remedy the situation. And unfortunately, not necessarily out of concern to the situation of the Arab citizens, but more out of concern to the economic interest of the state. That this discourse in itself has a bad impact on the relations between Jews and Arabs, in my opinion. And before I relate to the dangerous announcement of the extreme right wing during the approval of the plan, I want to dwell a little bit on the role of the Arab leadership in the development of this plan before it was approved. And actually what I can share with you is that the civil servants came to us, to our organization, asked us to make comments on the plan and to help to present it. And I think that this came out of the understanding among the Ministry of Finance people that there actually is a suspicion, a lack of trust of the Arab leadership towards the state, and that is actually based on a multi-year experience of disappointments from the continuous discrimination of the Arab population, and this is the situation among the leadership. You can just imagine what it is among the populations, although they want to integrate and become part of the society. What I can add to that is that the Arab population actually is fed up with years of promises of lies and continuous discrimination. On the one hand, you do not develop new cities or villages, you don't have public transportation or infrastructure or installations, and they don't help to develop the education or employment. On the other hand, that same government that discriminates and oppresses complains about the evil and the illegal ammunition, and this this is what the public, the Arab population, they themselves asked to deal with this issue of arms within the villages. All of a sudden it became a problem of the entire society. So the question is, where were you all these years, all these politicians and ministers that are now complaining about the crime and the illegal weapons that are all over the place in the Arab villages and towns? Another important point, when we try to analyze and to understand the rift and the dichotomy between the Arab leadership and the government, I think that here we cannot ignore the history and the former loads that make every Arab representative to doubt the seriousness of the government, even when it comes to amend and to help. This is actually, I can say, the reaction to this economic plan is a classic example of these difficulties after all these years. Another important thing, in my opinion, is this connection to the occupation and the impact of the occupation on the relations between Jews and Arabs in Israel. What a lot of the public, the Jewish public, doesn't understand that when you talk about Palestinians in the occupied territories of Gaza, we're talking about the same people, the same nation of the Palestinians who live in the State of Israel. And this ignoring these two groups, that it's actually one nation, one group, doesn't really contribute to improve the relations. So that every time that a Palestinian, a citizen of Israel, and many people prefer to call themselves like that and not Israeli Arabs, every time that one of us dares to criticize or protest against the siege of Gaza or the occupation, he's announced to be a traitor. And during the last escalation in the summer, we even witnessed that when Arab business people wanted to protest for everything that's happening in the territories and in Israel, and to close their businesses and to announce a total strike, then all of a sudden they were tagged or marked as terrorists. This is the most legitimate thing in a democratic society. And there are additional points, but yeah, we'll have time for more. Shireen, you're the principal of a mixed school in a mixed city. It'll be interesting to say, what happens with the youngsters, with the youth, your students? What do they think? How do they look at this entire situation? You know, those are going to be the citizens very soon in Israel. Hello everybody. I don't know if you thought about it, but after they finished 12th grade in my school, they tried to go to Dalia's organization and to get some sort of a chance and maybe become somebody, but in most cases it doesn't happen. And I am the voice that in most cases things never happen. They go back to the street, to the frustration. I'm a school principal. I have 1,175 students from 7th to 12th grade in a neighborhood. And I want to shatter that most of the Arabs in Israel have an illusion that the Jewish schools in Israel in the 21st century is there, and all the classrooms are well equipped and the teachers are all professionals, but in the Arab schools there's a 7th century. So as one who taught in a Jewish school for years, in many schools, Jewish schools, there too, it's the 7th century still. In the school system, there are a lot of problems, and I think that if we, as our population, will go out of the circle that we're in for many years, of the blaming, accusing, of why I don't have and they do have, and we'll start to shake ourselves and to take responsibility, we're going to be in a different place. all together. And I think that the only way to be in a different place is that the moment that we prove to ourselves, first of all, that we're able, and then the establishment will see in us something different that it didn't see us before. Somebody has to break through this circle, and I think that the only platform that can save the situation is the platform of the government schools. All the children of Israel go to kindergarten and first grade. In all these sectors, the state has the force and the power and the impact through the schools. The schools have a vision. The problem is that they don't implement this vision because the principals of the schools, especially the Arabs, think that their main role is to give matriculation diplomas. I, for one, think that I have to train a student. He should be a thinker, a scholar, somebody mature, critical, knows how to fight for his rights. Nobody gives rights to anybody in this country. You have to know how to take the rights. That's what I teach them. That's how I educate my students. I taught Ethiopian youth. It's not very easy for them either. The new immigrants also, it's not so easy. But there's one difference, and I agree with Dalia, there's a joint ethos to the Jewish society that we lack as an Arab society. At the age of 18, the Ethiopian and the new immigrant and the Moroccan and the Ashkenazi, they go to the army and they all become soldiers in the IDF, and you have the Holocaust Day and you have Memorial Day. There's something unifying, joint. We, the Arab population in Israel, we don't have a joint ethos with the Jewish population, and it's a problem. And if you want to solve the problem of our integration within the society, you have to create a joint ethos, but to give us the possibility to speak freely and respectfully on our ethos, the historic narrative. And I agree with the fact that to talk about my roots, because the theory of the melting pot, in my eyes, for years in the Jewish society, didn't succeed so well. This issue of the melting pot. The moment they wanted to put everybody into a mold and to make them forget where they came from, it doesn't work because you're creating people who are frustrated. No, you don't allow them to recognize their past. I'll tell you for a minute why I'm afraid as an educator, because I want to voice the problems of my students. First of all, the Arab society is not one mold. Dada is from Tira, Dada is from Kalansau. It's 5 minutes distance, but two different worlds. I come from the south of Lod, not from the north. And this is something you have to integrate. The Arab society is not one. And therefore the solutions are not unified. And the fate of a child from our neighborhood is not the same as somebody who studies in a Catholic monastery in Lod. If you want to change reality, you have to invest in the government education to allow my students in my neighborhood to dream, to be too ambitious. He shouldn't go into the internet and see a movie by Daesh, because it's the most heroic thing that he can do in life. It's sad, but this is realistic. That's what's happening today at this point of time. Thank you. We have another 8 minutes until we get thrown out of here. I want the three of you to relate to the connection between the fear and the chance. You spoke about Bad Daesh yesterday. The president of the state was here, and his thesis was based on the threat of Daesh. And he said Daesh is already here. So let's talk for a minute about this frightening topic. And how does it connect, or maybe it doesn't connect? You know, David Grossman explained that fear and victimization make you paralyzed. So let's go in the opposite order. The best thing to do against Daesh is not to talk about it. In other words, I think that Daesh is fed by the fact that everybody talks about it and afraid of it. I know that it sounds as if unreal, but it is actually... I hope I live after this panel. God knows what's going to await me. I had an experience in the past when I made statements, but I think that you have to understand what happened in the Israeli society. There's Arab youth that grows within the Israeli society. It looks what's happening from a militant point of view in the Israeli society. Take Lod, for example. An Arab child in Lod sees a Jewish child running with the Israeli flag, and he sees his neighbor preparing for the army. He sees the militant discourse. He sees soldiers and arms in the street. He also wants some, and I'm saying something, I know it's harsh, I don't compare, don't misunderstand me. There's something in this militant attitude that we take as self-evident, but it's not. In a real country, the army is not part and parcel of your regular existence. We are a society that the army is part and parcel of the existence. At the age of 18, I was an educator of soldiers, and it's not supposed to be self-evident. A regular Arab child, and I do want to talk about the extremist Islam. The only way to fight the radicalism is to educate them to an enlightened Islam. And everything that the Imam says in the mosque, to give him another phrase from the same Quran, from the same section. And what surprises me is that Arab principals in school avoid, don't dare to touch upon these issues of Daesh, of extreme Islam, and then the child grows within an empty vacuum, and the one who educates him is the Facebook and YouTube, and he doesn't have anybody to talk to. He doesn't have everybody to talk about his emotions. He goes to the street with this thing inside him, and I think that our role as educators, it's our responsibility as Arab society to explain to these youngsters and to educate them to the Islam that I'm proud to be part of, the enlightened Islam, and only this way can you fight against Daesh. It will take time, but I'm optimistic. If we, in our very difficult neighborhood, manage to have a school and to manage it according to the government rules and not by the neighborhood, maybe we can fight Daesh as well. Thank you, Shireen. Raunak, is there a chance? I always think there's a chance. That's why I work where I work. I also agree with Shireen that you have to fight the extremist Islam. But on the other hand, I want to say that part of the solution is to stop inciting against the existing framework among the Arab society and the less extreme establishment, and to take out the Islamic movement out of law, to make it outlaw, then of course that plays into the hands of Daesh. I think that I can mention that I don't agree with the religious positions of the Islamic movement, but that's not the issue. It's not an extreme movement. It includes a lot of the Arab people who believe in religion, but it's a legitimate movement, and if we really want to fight against the radical groups, at least let's respect the legitimate movements that do exist. And in this context, I want to say that my fear from excluding the Islamic movement and outlawing it, it actually can be the beginning of the road towards excluding many other groups that the government and that the public doesn't like to hear, like a ballad in the Knesset, etc. So apart from dealing with radicalism, it's also to destroy the what was left from the democracy, little by little. Dalia, just a few words to end. I'm saying that anybody who has what to lose is not going to jeopardize his life. How can you be surprised when you talk about Daesh that 56% of the crime in Israel happens in the Arab society? And this is obvious because 65% of the youth between 18 and 25 do not work and they don't study. So all these circles create people who have something to lose. They want to lose what they don't have because they don't have any hope. Two very important things in every discourse, every plan, every venture of integration of a joint society, education and economy. The Arab citizens or the Israeli Arabs or whatever they are, first of all, You have to go out from this place that Palestinian identity or Arab identity is a political concept, and you have to look at it as a cultural concept, as a value-based concept. It's enough to look at the identity as Palestinians or Arabs as politically threatening, and we must enable them and us to define ourselves and out of their own definition to integrate into the general definition of Israeliness. This place of economic integration and value-based integration in a very strong education system with objectives of higher education and good employment, these are the things that will bridge the gap. I personally decided a long time ago that I'm not a victim. I educate my children, and I am a principal of the school into a feeling of taking responsibility to lead the next stage of the Arab society. And I call it one word, enough, enough already, enough to be victims, enough to cry and whine. It's enough to wait until the state will start to initiate and to promote. I personally decided that I'm going to lead the next process. I'm not just the manager of the academic college, and this is a college which is located within the Arab society. For me to teach in the IDC is even a stronger message than the fact that I'm within my society. It's enough that my Jewish students after the army will say that one day. Not that the cleaning lady was an Arab, but the lecturer in the School of Governance was Arab. That's the change, as far as I understand. I just want to underscore that Daesh is not a danger just to the Israeli Jewish society, but it's a danger for me, people like me who try to lead the processes from within. Daesh is a joint enemy, and it's enough to look at Daesh as if it's an enemy that grows from within the Arab society and threatens the Jewish society. It threatens all of us, and we have to invest in the new generation of our children. Thank you, Dalia, Raumat, and Shirin. And I think that you spoke before of partnership rather than integration or inclusion. I think you are the ones who actually will create the change. Thank you very much.